confuse the people. Come to us now to fill our ears with the sound of your breath. Fill our eyes with the brilliance of your presence in each other. Fill our hearts with your good word. Amen. Please join me in a responsive reading of Psalm 104. O God, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures.
Your wonders is seen, greater than all. Creeping things from your beloved heart. Living things both small and great.
There goes the ships and Leviathan that you formed to sport in it. When you opened your hand, you were filled with good things.
When you hide your face, they are ashamed. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust.
When you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground.
May the glory of God endure forever. May God rejoice in God's works. Who looks on the earth.
I will sing to God as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being.
May my meditation be pleasing to God, for I shall rejoice in God.
Let sinners be consumed from the earth, and let the wicked be no more.
Praise God, O my soul, praise God.
I invite you to share your prayers of joys and concerns and news with one another. Today is Pentecost Sunday. It is when the church celebrates the birth of the church. And so after worship today, we're going to have some cake and refreshments to celebrate Pentecost, the day of Pentecost, in Fellowship Hall. Please stay if you can. Some good news, a new chairlift has been installed. So, and it's very comfortable, and for those who do need it, I hope that you will feel safe and comfortable using it. This Tuesday is our last Bible study class until the fall. We're going to begin a little bit later at 6:30 p.m. And I hope that you'll be able to join us. And please remember, next Sunday, we're having our summer picnic luncheon on the lawn after worship. And we're also going to place a time machine in the cornerstone of our church annex. And the forecast is supposed to be lovely like today. So please, if you can, please join us. And bring any friends, family, if you like. Let us pray. Loving God of spirit and truth, we have come to this place today to honor and worship you. May we still ourselves in your presence, seeking your peace for our souls. We are thankful for your goodness and provision, and for the way you are always present in our lives. We are thankful for your guidance, and for the way you constantly remind us of what you have taught us. We are thankful that you have given to us individual gifts and talents for the benefit of all, and where they are most needed. Thank you for this new day, another chance to seek to be more Christ-like in our ways. We thank you for your word that reaches us anew in our time and place, in a language we understand. Hear the prayers in our hearts. We pray for those of healing, send your healing spirit upon those who are sick in body or mind. Restore them to health and restore them to the joy of salvation. We pray for all those who are bereaved, for those who are ill and or awaiting hospital results or treatment. We pray for the medical teams attending to their needs. We pray for those with mental health struggles, with addiction issues, and the relationships and families that are affected. We pray for those who feel alone and unloved. We pray for all who have heavy hearts this day. We pray for those who are being persecuted because of their gender identity. We pray for our neighbors. Teach us to be good neighbors, to live in peace with one another, and in friendship, share the joys and burdens of daily life. We pray for our enemies. Bless our enemies and show us how we may do good to them for the sake of Jesus Christ. We pray for peace in every nation and on earth. We pray for the strengthening of democracy and democratic values. We pray for an end to war, fascism, and authoritarian values. We pray for planet Earth, our home. By your Spirit, renew the earth. Make us good stewards of its resources and teach us to enjoy its abundance rightly and justly. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit to be in our lives. Pour out your Spirit upon us anew and grant that we may speak your universal language of compassion, loving kindness, forgiveness, acceptance, generosity, and grace to all who will hear. We pray in the name of the risen Jesus, who is the way, and who is the truth, and who is the life, and who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
is from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 to 21. And if you'd like to read along in your pew Bible, it begins on page 992. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own language, we're hearing them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They're filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. "People of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken to the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Our gospel reading is from the gospel according to John, chapter 7, verses 37 to 39, on page 974. On the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart will flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive. For as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. The word of God. Because today is Pentecost Sunday, and red is the color of the Pentecost, and red is one of the colors of the Holy Spirit. The term Pentecost comes from the Greek word Pentecostos, meaning 50th, and it has its roots in the ancient Jewish calendar, which is known as the Feast of Weeks. In Hebrew, it's called Shavuot. This feast, which always occurs on the 50th day after Passover, marks the end of the grain harvest. In later centuries, rabbis came to identify this day as the day when the law, the Torah, was given to Israel at Mount Sinai. For Christians, Pentecost is the Christian reinterpretation of Shavuot. And on the Christian church calendar, Pentecost is the 50th and last day of the season of Easter. And today, in this country and around the world, many Christian churches are celebrating what we consider, the church considers, the birthday of the church. So happy birthday, church. And as I mentioned during the news and announcement portion of our worship, we will be having cake to celebrate. And so I hope you'll stay. For Christians, Pentecost represents not only the giving of the law, but also God's gracious decision, as Jeremiah says, to put the law within God's people, that is, to write it on their hearts. So how does God write the law on our hearts? God does it through the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. Pentecost is a commemoration of that special outpouring on Jesus' followers 50 days after his resurrection and ascension. On this day of Pentecost, we celebrate the arrival and the empowerment of that same Holy Spirit in and among us. My mother is a gardener. And many of you know that, for those of you who have heard my sermons, you know I speak about my mother a lot and I share lots of stories with her. So today I want to share another story about my mother. Years ago, a friend of mine had a dead potted orange tree. You look at it. Nothing. And she wondered, knowing that my mother was a gardener, she wondered maybe my mother could bring it back to life. Why not? Give it a chance. So she gave it to me to give to my mother. And after many months of meticulous care and attention, I could see the plant starting to recover, showing signs. But still though, it took a long time. And there were days when my mother thought, I don't know about this. And for weeks and weeks, I watched her take care of it, give it plant food, build up the soil. She would talk to the plant. She would handle the leaves that started to grow with gentleness and tenderness. And when I asked her how she knew when to water it, she said, "The plant will tell you. You just have to learn its language. You have to listen to the plant." She talked about being in relationship with the plant and how it's her duty to not give up on it and to take good care of God's creation. And after days and days of looking at the plant every day to see its progress, one day I saw a blossom. And then later I saw that first greenish kind of small little orange starting to grow until the day became that deep orange color that we love to see in an orange. It's still alive today, after all those years, and it's still blossoming. In fact, yesterday my mother said, come over here, look, because the plant is on our back porch. She said, look, see? And it had grown even twice the height, and you can see the blossom starting to form. This was my mother's witness to the power of the Holy Spirit to work through and in her. The Holy Spirit is the God who has created the world and has created each one of us and given us life. When we have felt like that plant and life is hard, the Holy Spirit comes and gives us new life and brings us forth. And like my mother, church, we tend to each other. We hold each other up. We sit with each other. We pray.
pray with each other, and we are renewed and restored. This is the promise of the Holy Spirit. This is Jesus' promise to us. The Holy Spirit is active in creation's renewal, and we are part of creation. We live in creation, and we are part of the restoration and renewal that the Holy Spirit promises that it will bring. We heard the words of the psalmist speaking of the Holy Spirit today, renewing the face of the earth. So not only earth, but all who live on earth, us included. The Holy Spirit is God at work making all things new. All things new. And this work of renewal is not instantaneous. Like my mother taking time. It takes time. But not time as we know it, but time as God knows it. We participate with the Holy Spirit who is outpouring onto us to facilitate the renewal of creation. We are active participants. And there are many things that might happen when we are impacted by the fullness of the Spirit. And one of those things is our ability to receive a message from God in human language. Put another way, the phenomena of prophecy. The Holy Spirit is the messenger that brings God's message to us. And that is exactly what we find in the Pentecost story of Acts. When the Spirit came, oh, she got the attention of everyone who was gathered there in one place with loud, violent winds whirling around, crashing, disorienting, confusing, frightening people. Yes, that's how the Spirit can come to us sometimes. The Spirit can frighten us with the message that she's bringing to us, and we may not like it, but it is coming from God, because God is telling us what we need at this time. It was so intense. And Luke describes it as tongues of fire resting on each of them. And this outpouring was for everyone who had gathered that day and beyond. For all, regardless of gender, age, linguistic background, socioeconomic status. And everyone understood and communicated with one another. It created a strong sense of togetherness and unity through diversity. The Spirit gave them ability to speak across barriers, all kinds of barriers, whatever barriers they had in reality or in their lives and their minds. And it challenged them to challenge the stereotypes in their lives and their biases and to step beyond, and to value the cultural and linguistical diversity among them in a way, in a new way, in a faithful way. And this story also gives us Peter's response, his beautiful response, rooted in the law, rooted in God's word. And his response was extraordinary. And he recited, recalling the words of the prophet Joel. According to Joel, the purpose of Spirit's outpouring is so that all God's people may prophesy about the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day, the day that heralds both judgment and salvation. And that outpouring extends to us this morning, this day, at Moorsmere. The Holy Spirit is empowering us to speak to our time, to speak to this day. Empowering us to take a stand and identify the principalities and powers of evil and oppression that ravages people's lives, communities, and the earth. And on that day, the Spirit transformed this diverse group of ordinary, imperfect, and frightened people into the body of Christ in order for them to continue the work that Jesus has started. And this new church that the Spirit called into being was a spirited community of bridge builders, visionaries, and dreamers. Male and female, slave and free, Jews and Gentiles. It was diverse, inclusive, and egalitarian. The Judeans learned that the Galileans were not backwards, ignorant, and dirty, as they were always told about the Galileans. The ones born and raised in Judea saw the immigrants who were now living in Jerusalem as equally deserving to live in the city. Women took on leadership roles with the full support of men. The Spirit empowered the crowd and set them on a path of a Spirit-filled, lifelong journey of faith and opened up new horizons of ministry. And that same Holy Spirit is present with us today. And the outpouring of the Holy Spirit impacts us beyond this kind of prophetic word that we are empowered to speak. Out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water. Out of the believer's heart shall flow the rivers of living water. Our hands, our mouth, our bodies, our hearts, everything, our entire being receives the Holy Spirit for renewal and restoration for what God has tasked us for this day. And we ask the Spirit to tell us, what is it, God, that you want us to do this day? What is your will for us this day? And the Spirit will carry us out of suspicion, tribalism, and fear, and bring us further into that inclusion, that loving kindness, that sense of community that is ever expanding, ever growing, ever deepening, and into a new way of loving God and loving our neighbor. And the Spirit reminds us again and again, put God in the center of your life. Put love in the center of your life. Our relationship with God, who is love, is the most important thing in our lives. So my blessing for you on this day, when we celebrate the church, this home of ours, this place that gives us so much in ways that we may not know, that blesses us. May the rivers of living water flow out of your hearts into the world. May you be the living water that replenishes parched lands. May you take your thirst for change and be a blessing unto the world. May you be the salt that heals the world. And may you be the arms that hold hurting and broken bodies. And may you cry tears for those who have been treated unjustly. May you be the hearts that pray for one another and for God's people and God's creation. And may you rest in God's love, knowing that you are so loved, and be comforted by that truth. Be still and know that God is with you now and always. God has empowered us to live into this overflowing outward work of the Holy Spirit, to participate in the renewal of the face of the earth. Be blessed by God's love. Be blessed by Peter's words this day. Love God, love your neighbor. Share the love that God has shown you with all. God bless you. Amen. At the birth of the church, all who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. The work of the Holy Spirit flows like living water from the hearts of believers. May we give without measure so that the larger family of faith may be a vessel of good news, of love, of God's love to the world.
Thank you.
blessings, brothers and sisters. God's Holy Spirit goes with you, blows with you, and flows with you, filling your hearts with dreams, your minds with visions. So let us be living water flowing from within this worship service out to a thirsty world. Go in peace, go in love. Amen.